Welcome back to The Breakfast. The conversations continue this morning. We're now going to be talking about, more from the kidnap of more than 300 students from a school in Katsina State. The nation, of course, has been asking for President Muhammadu Buhari to take action, but at the same time, there's talks about should he visit the school and the families of these students that have been kidnapped? A few days ago, of course, he headed off to Daura. There were short videos also of the president inspecting his cows, having meetings with friends and family, and of course the governor of Katsina State, Aminu Masari, went visiting. We've invited Chidi Omeje this morning to share his thoughts on the these issues. Good morning and thank you for joining us, Mr. Omeje.
Good morning and thank you for having me.
All right, I'll start with the skepticism around the calls for the president to go see the school or the students. Some people say he doesn't have an antecedent that he goes to show concern, but he uses people who have been employed for that purpose. Put that alongside the concern that at least the empathy would matter to those who have been, who are suffering at the moment. What is your perspective on all of these arguments?
Well, naturally, the least expectation is that Mr. President should be able to empathize with the community. Naturally, he should be there to, see things for himself. That is what we expect. But sometimes also we may not know what he knows. That's what you call intelligence report, or the reality of intelligence report. You don't know, and I don't know what the chief security officer around him may have uncovered. Probably it might not be in the best security interest of Mr. President to be there at this point in time, because things are probably there are some issues around the area that might not be quite safe for the president. But that's not to me, but that's just to say it as it is, that indeed sometimes there are things we might not know that they know better that could explain something that naturally to us it seems very inexplicable, that the president is there in Kaduna, in Katsina State, in Katsina, Daura rather, and I understand that from Daura to that Kankara place is just about 15 minutes drive. So ordinarily, one would have expected the president to at least to show up there to take a look at things, and then to, optics matter. People around there would say, oh yeah, Mr. President was here to empathize with us. That would have been fine. But like I said, you never can tell. Probably there are some, security issues around the situation that may not be safe enough for him to be there.
Mr. Omeje, you just mentioned, it might not be in his best interest, it's maybe not the right time for him to visit. I remember we also had a similar argument when there was an attack in Benue State a few years ago where about 87 people were killed. There was a similar argument. The president, of course, eventually, after maybe a week or more, visited and made statements saying that he had sent the Inspector General of Police, to Benue State and was shocked that he wasn't present. But we've continued to, see the same or very similar feedback from the presidency, and like you've just mentioned, maybe not in his best interest. Is there a time when it might be different? Is there a time when it might be safe enough for the president to show the empathy that Nigerians are asking for? Can the Nigerian security agencies assure President Muhammadu Buhari that it is safe enough for you to empathize with victims of these disasters?
Look. Ordinarily, if we're in normal times, or maybe we have just had a security breach, an exceptional security breach, it won't be necessary for us to discuss it, because the natural thing is that Mr. President ought to see things for himself, especially when he's in Katsina State, just a short distance from Daura where he's staying to Kankara where it happened. Ordinarily, that should have been a given. But the point is that we are in an extraordinary time. We are in a situation of quote-unquote war. And, like I said, I'm not here to hope for Mr. President. I, for one, would have expected him to be there to see this for himself. But like I said, maybe there are things that we don't know.
Okay.
So, but
let me quickly interject and put it out there that there was a video that is also causing disaffection among some Nigerians of the president visiting his cows. You know, people say if you can do that, you can also go and show some empathy with those who need it, that are humans, that can actually reciprocate you touching them. I want you to look at the development from the kidnap. The governor of that state has confirmed that they are in touch with those who kidnapped the boys, and he's also saying that the security agencies have located where these boys are. This kind of narrative, you know, reminds us of the kind of narrative we heard during the Chibok and Dapchi schoolgirls. What concerns, what worries you really about this narrative at this time? Should they be telling us that they've located these children, or they'll be showing us videos of the children being released?
I mean, that I like that last part of it. What would have expected, what every Nigerian, every human being would expect at this point in time is to see those kids released to us. But you have to understand that this is a very delicate situation. It might be very, very true and possible that they may have identified where the kids are or where the bandits are with the kids. But given the sensitivity, given the delicate nature of this particular situation, you don't expect them to begin to engage them fire for fire. There has to be, you know, this is when you bring the fine art of statecraft, the fine art of negotiation, the fine art of conflict management. Because if you don't take time, these guys could very well open fire on our kids. And which one is better? So I think that, yes, it is possible they might have seen where they are, but they're taking their time to ensure that no much collateral damage, no much damage, no much, casualty. Because we are dealing with, you know, people who are most times, drug-induced, people who don't have control of their minds, people who are really blood-thirsty, people who don't think the way you and I think, because no more human being will do what they're doing. So you are dealing with people who have sold their souls to the devil and who don't care how you feel. In fact, the more they inflict pain on you, the more satisfied they are. That is the nature of their business. So it's up to you as a government or the military authority to be careful the way you deal with the situation. Otherwise, you end up, you know, going there with body bags to pick up boys, which is not what we want. So, naturally, we would expect to see these guys, our boys coming out, but we have to be careful.
Yes.
And that's what I think is.
Junior Major.
Yes, please.
This sounds very much a broken record already. And the reason I say that is because we've heard these things before. The same thing you just mentioned now about, you know, you have to be tactical. You need to, you know, be careful about how you go about a rescue mission so you don't, you know, endanger the victims even more. We've heard that before. We've heard that during the Chibok, you know, girls. We heard that during Dapchi. But it doesn't seem like there is, you know, a lot of the actual tactics that, you know, came into play eventually. So it's for me, it's bringing back really bad memories of when Chibok happened and when Dapchi happened. Another thing that we've also heard before is that the president doesn't need to be there to rescue the people by himself. It's not important that he shows up. He is given marching orders to security agencies to do what is necessary. So how would you respond to that? You know, and do you agree that, I mean, his presence is not going to rescue them, you know, after all. So why should he even bother? As long as he's given the marching orders to his security agencies, then, you know, we should all relax and wait for them to act.
No, I don't subscribe to that particular sentiment. Look, my initial statement, when I said there might be things they know that we don't know in terms of intelligence reports, I'm not trying to say that the president should not find it in his heart to see it as a priority to be there. Whether it is going to help or not, the point is that he's the commander-in-chief, and the fact that he's there, you know, kind of confidence building, I would have expected him to be there, assuming there is no adverse security report. So that's bad. way. So, but I think also that the important thing really, the president being there is more like in confidence building and more like for optics' sake. But the real issue, the real deal, is those who are engaged in that particular negotiation. Those who will be, look, as we're talking now, there had to be what we call kinetic and non-kinetic presence there. The kinetic there is our military guys being around, being very alert, very armed, ready for any action. Then the non-kinetic will be those guys who will do the entire negotiation. So both situations go pari passu. As you are having your foot on ground, so you are having your carrot. So as you are discussing, you are also equally ready and alert, so that if these guys could decide to do something, you could come in. But you don't, you are not going to be careless about it. You have to be very careful because you're talking about 333 kids in one space. So anything can happen. You don't know the kind of arm they have there. What if they have something that can detonate on the boys? So you have to be really careful. So, I know the emotions are high. Our expectations are really high. And especially, so we deserve to see our boys out. But if you want to be realistic, you know that you have to be careful about it. Otherwise, you might get what you don't bargain for.
All right.
What I'm saying.
I want to look at the general security situation. Yes, this boy's return is imperative. But we also know that just weeks ago, over 40 farmers were killed. They were buried the next day. We also know that kidnapping is growing in Oyo. We heard that people were kidnapped. We know that people are being held for ransom. It seems like a routine now. The Sultan of Sokoto has come up to say the situation is growing worse. How do we even asking that question is becoming, it sounding a little mundane to me, but it has to be asked. How do we begin to get out of this? How do we begin to see a leadership from those who truly should be leading, especially with the cases of COVID-19 that we're hearing among our security officers?
You see how things, we have a whole lot of things on our plate. Things are quite complicated for the country right now, security-wise, health-wise, a lot of things, economy, all manner of things. So, but I tell you something. I remember, don't forget that I am a journalist like you, and I remember interviewing the former Chief of Defense Staff, talking about Chief Marshal Petering, and I asked him about this kind of situation, and what exactly is the role of everybody when the country is at war? Let me tell you, it's not just the military guys that ought to be engaged in this situation. Every Nigerian have to be involved. You and I have to be involved. The media have to play their roles. The citizens on the street have to play their roles. The role of information sharing, see something and say something. Role of supporting the military, not bring down their morale. Role of gallivanting public support. For our troops, and not to be in cahoots with people who want to play down their efforts. These are things we need to do at this point in time. This is not the time for us to detach ourselves and say, look, it is your role, it is the leadership role. It is the entire country's situation now. We have to come together. We have to speak in one voice. We have to act in concert with each other. We have to make sure that we support the government, especially when they are doing the right thing. But when they're not doing the right thing, we'll call them out most constructively to ensure that things get done well. So right. I am worried as a Nigerian that things are really going out of hand. There are so many theaters of absurdities in this country now, theaters of insecurities, the Northeast, the Northwest, North Central, the Southeast. Almost every part of the country is engulfed in one crisis or the other. So I am saying here that, yes, when a country finds itself in this kind of situation, what the best thing to do is to get united more, to speak in one voice, and to tone down the volume of criticisms, especially when it is going to be turned to cynicism, no longer criticism. So we need to, play more unity in this. But let me just say this. That is not to say that the military or the government or the leadership should not play the key role they ought to play. They have to be the leaders they are. They have to provide leadership. They have to provide direction. They have to provide, they have to show us the way. But if they begin to do things that are very untoward, things that we don't expect, yes, we are doing the right right to call them out, to say, you're not doing this right. And I think that's exactly what most people are saying, especially the Mr. President, who find it difficult to show empathy without a good explanations.
All right. Finally, I want to, you know, ask your own personal thoughts now. Of course, not trying to be pessimistic here, but we saw, you know, how the Chibok girls, you know, story played out. You know, we still have a lot of them missing, unaccounted for. We also saw, you know, the Nigerian government's efforts with regards to the Dapchi girls and the level of success that was recorded. Do you expect, you know, are you optimistic about the rescue of these boys? Do you think that, you know, maybe we'll be able to pull the same strings that we pulled with the Dapchi girls to bring these boys back before it's too late?
Yeah, good question. A very good question, I think. I think the difference between this particular Kankara issue and Chibok is time. Yes. Don't forget that in Chibok time, we had almost 3 weeks lacuna. Right, the government, the direction time was, you know what I mean? But in this case, I think the government and the military, for instance, were able to, you know, commence action immediately, just 2 or 3 days after, a day or two after the incident. So that means that the bandits or whoever is in custody of these kids will not have the opportunity to go far. I want to believe now, as we're talking, that the troops, if they know what they are doing by now, should be able to condone a whole sort of areas to make sure that those guys not slip probably into Nigeria Republic or wherever. But you know, in the case of Chibok, we had about 3 weeks, you know, lapse, so that those guys were able to move further into the abyss where they're hiding. But in this situation now, and that gives me confidence that these guys will be released. But their release will be a function of the quality of negotiation and negotiating skills from our own side, because those adversaries, all they want, from what I heard, they are already asking for ransom. If you heard what the governor said, I think they want some money paid. It might not be the ideal thing to pay money to terrorists, because I know they are terrorists. I don't buy the idea of bandits. You know, okay. It's not good to pay money to them. But when you have the kind of situation, what do you do? Whatever it takes to get the kid out, if you are the parent, if you are in the shoes of the parents, you will say, oh, pay the money and let me have my kids back. So right. I believe that they will be out by grace of God, and by
God,
of
course,
to our support of Nigerians, support the troops to make sure that they do what they're doing. We shouldn't be able to distract them. We have to look. Let me emphasize this. We have to play a key role of supporting these troops at this point in time.
All right, Mr. Chidi Omeje. I'm afraid that's the much time will permit us on this segment. I want to say thank you very much for joining us and sharing your thoughts on the matter.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
Have a good day.
I was wondering what role we should play, you know, what level of
support. He said something that I had to write down so I don't forget. He said, when you see something, you say something. But we don't have the trust. We keep talking about the trust deficit here, and it sounds like, you know, we're repeating it too much. But it is important. When you give information and you become the person who will be arrested to provide further information, you'll be interrogated for providing information that the security agencies are supposed to go and investigate and use. People don't want to put themselves out because they don't trust that they will be secure in the first instance for giving information to the police. I know there are other mechanisms for getting info to the police force, but if we do not address the trust deficit, which is something we're going to be talking about after this break we're going on, the aftermath of the EndSARS protests, if there doesn't seem to be a give and take, like we give you one, you give us another, and we are not moving forward when it comes to seeing these tangible changes, see something, say something. Remain words.
I'm really just worried about why this sounds so much like, you know, it's like deja vu, basically, you know, and with similar statements, with similar narratives, similar excuses, similar, you know, plans, you know, when, you know, you're reading the news, oh, they've located, I've heard that line before, you know, we're negotiating, I've heard that before. I've heard also, you know, the president doesn't need to be there, he's given marching orders, I've heard all those things before. What I haven't seen is...
something different in response. Yes. Well, we haven't seen that yet. Maybe some, by some miracle, we'll see in the coming days. We'll keep
Hello.
You posted.
Hope you enjoyed the news. Please do subscribe to our YouTube channel and don't forget to hit the notification button so you get notified about fresh news updates.